When I was growing up, everyone I knew had a home. But the last time there was more affordable housing than people who needed it was in 1970, nearly half a century ago. In today's America, the impoverished citizens of an invisible nation struggle to survive among us. Merging into the background of our daily lives, they seek shelter on the streets, under bridges, in vehicles, abandoned buildings, and hidden camps across the country. Yet they are as inconsequential and forgettable as yesterday's newspaper. The exact number of Americans living under conditions unfit for human habitation remains elusive. However, it is estimated to be in the millions.
So how can you say United we stand here in the richest continent on earth, and you got people here that don't have housing and don't have health care? I don't understand it.
I'm hopeful to have a warm place to sleep tonight. However, I've already made the stop in, and they denied me. So I'm looking towards trying to find a place where I can sleep restfully and safely and in warmth tonight.
Michael Vester, Victor Hunter, Billy Johnson, Delonte Johnson.
It is more than usually desirable that we should make some slight provision for the poor and destitute.
Are there no prisons?
Plenty of prisons.
And the union workhouses, are they still in operation?
They are. I wish I could say they were not.
And the treadmill and the poor law, they're still in full vigor, I presume?
Many can't go there,
and some would rather die.
If they would rather die, they'd better do it and decrease the surplus population.
I call it normality of normality of life. And whereas I was smarter, my memory's not so good. I'm not able to really, I ain't even got a telephone. When I leave my camp, I would dance through the red light with my dog. My dog got killed by the train. And all of a sudden, I realized I had eaten 3 days. I hadn't slept in 3 days. And I didn't really understand why I had that brain injury. Blood was still in my brain, too, and I didn't even know it. And then when they took me to the emergency room, when the nurse came in, the fact was the head nurse, she came in, and she stuck a thing in my arm, and she said, "Oh, you're just homeless, oh, you're just going to do that." I said, "Please shut the fuck up." And then a doctor woman came in together, and, "Tommy, we're glad you're okay. We're going to get you checked out." I could have probably died. That's probably what would have happened to me. There is thousands of people in the last 10 years diagnosed, died. Just leave the hospital that's been denied. Bam, die. Get cut, not get the help that's supposed to be there for them. So why is people going to just look at the homeless? They're pieces of shit. They're this, this, that, and the other. Why not come and kill us all then?
And not only would you feel like that, but the people that I'm seeing, they feel like that, but then things are happening. They're getting raped on the street, or they're getting beat up, or they're getting robbed constantly, just week after week after week. And, you know, if they never had PTSD, they're sure to have it at that point. But then in some ways, the stigma has become normal, and so it's normal to think bad about it, and it's normal to not help.
In my world, I assume every single person that is experiencing homelessness that I'm engaging with has a trauma history, every one of them. And we know that the event of homelessness in and of itself is traumatic. And when you find yourself homeless, you are suddenly moved from this mainstream community that we all know really well, right into that homeless community. And I want you to think about that for a second, right? Everybody in this room, if you tomorrow had to go out as a homeless individual, does that not scare you?
It's just the fear of not knowing. You know, I would find myself in a panic just as to where I'm going to sleep or where I'm going to stay. And if I was told I couldn't stay or I didn't have a place to stay, I would panic because I'd always have a roof over my head. I've slept on the ground, I've slept on the concrete, I've slept on a loading dock, I've slept in a tent. There are some very good people out here, some very bad people out here, and I've seen both sides of that.
I was in the hospital most every night for depression. And it was rough. And I think a lot of it was because I was on the street. I'm staying downtown now, but I was out on East Stone behind on the Greenbelt stand, just on a mattress with blankets, open to wildlife, open to people coming up, sneaking up on me. And I've been out there, jumped 3 times out there, been beat and almost killed out there.
When I did live in Sacramento, I was actually getting out of an abusive marriage. So I ended up on the street. I ended up on the street for 4 years. The homeless population in Sacramento, when I lived there, there was almost 600 of them were homeless. And there's not very many places for them to go to seek shelter. So you ended up finding it wherever you could, which mostly meant finding places where the police couldn't get to. Because if they found you on the side of a building or under a bridge, they would tell you the first time to leave. The second time, it was a fine, and the third time, it's a week in jail.
Us women have it bad out here. And the men, they have it somewhat easy. You know, certain places, you can go use the bathroom, take a shower, and clean up, and certain places can't. They will, they'll say, no, you can't come in here. You're homeless. We don't want to serve you. Bye. Leave. You know, that right there irks me too.
When you do that day after day after day, and you're living in what we call a hypervigilant state because you're trauma triggered, at some point, we need a break from that. And the cheapest and easiest break, drugs and alcohol. If I was shoved into homelessness tomorrow, I can't tell you that I wouldn't use.
I had no sense of directions. Some days I didn't even want to live. You know, it got to that point where I just wanted to die. Because I didn't want to continue to use drugs, but I didn't want to continue to live life either because of the way that I was feeling about myself. You know, I had very low self-esteem. You know, I was very angry. Throughout my life, I've been angry due to situations and circumstances that has happened to me and situations and circumstances that I had put myself in. You know, and it was, a lot of them were not pretty.
Studies now show that 92% of homeless women with children have severe histories of childhood trauma, neglect, addictions, and then also get in relationships where there's domestic violence. And so if there was any disease we were treating, and we could say 92% of the reason why you have this disease is X factor, then we would, as a society, address X factor. And really could almost see it, you know, maybe obliterated. Trauma is kind of a thread that weaves through a lot of different programs that are offered in our communities. And historically, we've been treating these symptoms, but now we've learned that recognize that they're really adaptations to things that folks have experienced that many times were no fault of their own.
I found myself sleeping in outside a Subway, and I'd be there night after night, and people giving me food to eat, boxes to lay on, newspapers to lay on, freezing, cold rain, soaking wet, covered in soot. A lot of them out there will try and get you in to have sex for money. How about a drug? Do something for me. Questions like that. You want to go home? I can take care of you for a night, for an hour. And then, of course, the fear of, you know, eventually when I finally went to the doctor, you know, am I sick or not from all that? Because I was raped out there, too.
Whether you're living in a street or in a shelter, for every health condition, homeless people suffer from those conditions at higher rates. Homeless people also die prematurely and die at faster rates, especially homeless people who are living on the streets.
I am originally from Arkansas. I became homeless at the end of November. I was in a very abusive relationship. I figured anywhere was better than where I was at, and ended up in Kingsport, Tennessee, completely out of funds. I had no money, no food, no resources. I was there for maybe, I'd say maybe 2 or 3 days, and I became ill. I have end-stage COPD.
And the Salvation Army wouldn't let me in because of the insurance. And so I went up Buffalo Mountain and camped out in 15 degree at night. Took about 4 days. Couldn't keep enough firewood. You'd work 6 hours to get firewood and you'd burn it up in 3. And my feet got frostbit and then gangrene set in, so they had to amputate.
If people don't receive primary care or preventive care, when they seek care, especially if they are unstably housed, it's going to be at a state where it's emergent. So they'll end up using the emergency room, which is expensive. And they homeless people get hospitalized at higher rates, and that's extremely expensive. And when they are hospitalized, they have many complications. So what that is doing is it's not only bad for the individual, and it's not only bad for the society, it is also costing taxpayers more dollars than it would cost to provide primary care.
The car breaks down or your kid gets sick, you don't go to work, you lose your job, you're evicted. And that takes place in 30 to 45 days. My classic picture I see is mama's walking in the door with the clothes and the trash bags and the kid standing next to them, wondering how they got there. 6 weeks ago, I was doing good, and now I'm coming to a homeless shelter. And that's how close it is in America.
In the 70s, there really was an adequate supply of affordable housing. That is, there were enough low-cost units for all the households that needed them. And since then, there's developed a huge deficit. So now we're millions and millions of units short of having enough affordable housing units for the people who need them. The vast majority of poor people are spending more than half of their income for housing, and that just means more people are likely to become homeless.
Well, we stayed at an efficiency apartment, so it was about $235 a week.
So it got hard
every
quick.
Week. As soon as you get a check, that's coming straight out of your check.
It took everything we made.
We probably lived off of about $20 every week. That's what we had after we paid our rent to, you know, eat off of and get shampoo and stuff like that. And
the basics.
Yeah. I'm not trying to live like millionaires. I just want to live like a normal person.
If you look at housing costs, the average apartment in Kingsport, two bedroom, was $550 plus your electric bill. That's $650. It takes an income of $1,800 a month to support that. Minimum wage is $7.70 an hour. You've got to be moderate income to be able to afford housing here in Kingsport.
You know, when you're a kid, you dream about the big cars, nice house and everything. Right now, I'm just thinking of a car to drive, get me point A to point B, work, and just a shelter. Maybe pay $350 a month. It doesn't have to be the best, but it's off these streets.
You know, your brain is focused on the things that it has to have for the body to survive, and one of those is a place to live. And it's gonna have a very hard time, you know, setting itself to getting clean and sober or being compliant with meds or doing a budgeting plan when you don't have a place to live.
I first experienced homelessness about 2011, 2012, right around that time. But after a while, granted there are some people who love being on the streets, but after a while for me, it got tiring because I needed a place to stay. That's not who I am.
So giving people that platform of housing is what lets them then achieve well-being. It comes first.
Nobody knows you when you're down and out. I mean, when you're down.
Nashville is one of the fastest growing cities in the U.S. With 2 million people living in Nashville's metropolitan area, and more than 15 million tourists visiting the city every year, real estate speculation is booming, with signs of construction everywhere. But for Nashville's homeless citizens forced to live on the streets, there are only temporary shelters, and the urgent drumbeats of change are no match for the deafening roar of development.
News Channel 5 Network. This is Open Line.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to Open Line, a very important show tonight. We are talking about homelessness and its correlation to our city's lack of affordable housing. The fact of the matter is, the number of homeless people who have died in Nashville is increasing. It's increasing year after year. And some believe you can directly tie that to our lack of affordable housing.
So we believe housing is a human right, because to live without housing is to live in subhuman conditions. I know several people who died while they were waiting for housing. We believe it's because of the long waits, and people that are already medically fragile and vulnerable are being forced on even longer waiting lists right now. So we think there's a direct correlation to the lack of affordable housing and to the units of affordable housing that we're losing in our city due to development.
This is my city. I'm a Nashvilleian. When you look, you can see the cranes. And they're building hotels, they're building garages, they're building condos. And I know if you can take a molded piece of bread and make penicillin, you should be able to figure out a way how to house people that don't have housing.
Every morning I get to see the capital city, Nashville, Tennessee. And I see 1, 2, 3, 4 cranes. And it's a shame that nothing's being built for people like me and my other brothers and sisters that are in the same predicament of not having a place to call home. I've slept up under bridges, railroad tracks, park benches, bus benches. I've watched some of my extended family be killed. This is happening, and this is an epidemic now. This is a real, truly an epidemic.
Howard Allen Jr. first experienced homelessness in 2001. After living on the streets for years, Howard co-founded the Nashville Homeless Underground to bring attention to the overwhelming hardships facing those without shelter. He regularly appears in the media and is actively involved in raising public awareness about the homeless crisis.
Whenever there's a hurricane or a tornado or whatever, the volunteer stays always there to help. and I think it's time for us to clean up our front yard and our backyard. Affordable housing generates taxes. Okay. Low-income housing doesn't.
So when we talk about affordable housing moving forward, we are going to have to answer that question as a city. Mm-hmm. Affordable for who?
So it's getting really, 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 really bad out here. And we got to make a change. We got to make a change. And like I said, it could happen to anybody. A fire, a hurricane, a tornado, rent going up, a loss of a job, and you could be homeless.
Howard's office is the computer room at the Nashville Public Library, which, like libraries across the country, has become an ad hoc day center for the homeless community.
This place here is like holy ground to me. I get my inspiration from my brothers and sisters that find a way to make it from day to day. We're getting killed sometimes just like these people did, you know, for just being homeless. Sometimes we're being criminalized for just being homeless. And Donald Trump says we're gonna have to make America great again. How in the hell can you make America great again when you got an epidemic of people, human beings, that are homeless? Not just here in Tennessee, but all over the United States. It's sad. It's really sad, you know? How you doing, Reverend Handy?
It's interesting when you talk about poverty. One thing I know about poverty is it doesn't discriminate.
No.
But Jesus says you'll always have the poor with you, not meaning you'll have the poor with you because the poor will be with you. You'll have the poor with you because of the decisions that you've made to keep the poor poor.
The first apartment I went to, I had the money right in my hand. I had $600 right in my hand. Down payment, I covered down payment, application fee, whatever they needed, rent and all that, right? A couple of weeks later, they let me know that I wasn't approved. I'm like, why? I got a full-time job. I'm able to pay rent. The rent's only $525 a month. I make about $820 a week. What's the problem? Come to find out, well, sir, you have bad credit. Really? I have bad credit. What has that got to do with me not being able to pay my rent? I'm trying to find a place to live. I'm trying to get off the streets. You should be ashamed, big time. If you can't get a person off the streets that's trying to help themselves, it's one thing a person that's not trying to help themselves, they're gonna be in that situation because they don't care. But a person that actually cares, get that person off the street, man.
But they haven't been homeless. They haven't experienced. They haven't seen. And like B.B. King says, you can't sing the blues if you don't know the blues. You know, if you haven't experienced it. Well, I experience it every day. And while they're talking and doing what they're doing, we're dying.
I knew that's okay. I'm looking at it now because I stand in encampment. They're going to tell me to move or whatever. And if I don't move or if I'm on the street, they're going to criminalize me for being homeless. And I don't have a place to stay. So this will be, I guess, my affordable house.
You know, if somebody misses income for 6 weeks, they're going to go down, you know, because they're very struggling right now. And the ones, all the affordable housing that is in Nashville is all taken. It's like they stopped taking Section 8 applications because there's a 4-year waiting list. And nobody's, you know, if they've got it, they're not letting it go. So that's more affordable housing that's getting gone, you know. And I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know what can happen. The whole system needs a big overhaul. There's no excuse for it. There is no middle class anymore, I don't believe. You got rich and then you got poverty. That's it.
But this was an event that changed me because today I'm still a face of homelessness. And this is named after Tara and all the homeless that perished. So we've been meeting here ever since. It took 8 years to get this bench. She didn't die in vain and none of my brothers and sisters died in vain. And we're celebrating lives today. Of people that are houseless. I don't like the word homeless. It's been a hell of a year for people without housing. Some people call me the mayor of the homeless, the voice. I'm just a guy without housing, but I'm a poverty scholar. I have my back turned to you because this is what it feels like to us when you turn your back on homeless people every day. When you sit down and talk to someone without housing, you'll see how much character we do have to be able to keep on believing, to keep on having hope.
And we all have character. We're all brothers and sisters. And it's time to change.
There are obstacles in terms of studying as well as understanding homelessness. And I think one of the errors that we often make is we assume that the homeless person or homelessness represents a uniform population. And that complicates not only the definition of homelessness, but it also makes it difficult at times and poses challenges to studying homelessness. Generally, in our studies, we've identified three different types of homelessness. The first is situational homeless. A person loses a job, a home burns, something happens, a crisis, a health situation, something causes them to become homeless. This is probably the largest group of homeless, but the less visible. The second group is what we call the episodically homeless. Sometimes people will say this is the couch population. If the person has it the first of the month, some income, they may be able to rent a room, or it may be that they can stay with a relative or a friend. Now the final group is the chronic homeless. The chronic homeless is probably the smallest group of homeless, but it's the most visible. And I think this is what the public often views as homelessness. And generally we describe chronic homelessness as a person who has been homeless for a year or more. It's been estimated that this group, it represents about 10 to 20% of the homeless population. But the interesting thing is, it's probably the most costly group in terms of the use of public services.
For our count, we have a very strict definition of homeless that only includes people who are sleeping in emergency shelters or in places not meant for human habitation or not meant to be used as a bed. So chronic homelessness has been the target for a number of years now. These are the hardest to serve individuals, the ones who've been homeless the longest. They're the ones that have disabling conditions that make it particularly difficult to both serve them and keep them housed. And so more of the dollars have gone towards programs that are providing that and meeting that need.
So the PIT stands for point in time count. So it's a 24-hour. It is mandated by HUD that we enumerate the number of homeless individuals in a 24-hour period. This occurs nationwide, so we are not the only ones doing it. It's occurring all across the nation. HUD requires that we do it in the last 10 days of January, so there is some flexibility.
On a given night in January, for a 24-hour period, we're required throughout the country to count all the homeless that are chronically homeless. The purpose is to match the services available to the number of people that you have on the street in that given time. And it also gives you a base with which to measure your homeless population from year to year.
And we're down around the railroad track area, just close to the Salvation Army, and we're going to go and view a couple of camps that have been located in this area.
The woman that lives here, during the daytime, she takes care of an older lady up the hill there. But at nighttime, she spends her time down here. I guess that's her home now.
This camp has been abandoned for about 6 to 8 months, and there was at one time 4 people that stayed here plus a dog. You notice the wood? And then you got the tarp. This place caught on fire. That's why they left it. Like I say,
fairly big.
they left in a hurry. And right up there is where they would be at.
After hours of searching, the survey team takes a short break at a service station where they encounter their first homeless person of the night.
All right, we'll put that down. Okay. Okay. Now,
most people, when they see me, they just won't even talk to me. I put in applications everywhere, but I can't even get McDonald's to give me a job. We had a guy tonight actually try to come in and burn our mattress that we have up there. So the other night, one of my buddies right up here, he got jumped by three guys, just kids out being crazy. They don't understand. All we're trying to do is get some rest and survive the same as they are. Yeah. It's a little bit harder for us. I am able to get food stamps. They give me $60 a month. Like I said, I've been about 3 years now, almost 3 years, and I just look at it as a long camping trip. It lasts all four seasons.
While field survey teams comb the countryside, Shades of Grace, a storefront church in Kingsport, invites the homeless in out of the cold for something to eat. Volunteers are on hand to conduct hit count interviews in a respectful and confidential manner.
Is there anybody that hasn't stopped at the table yet? Can I just see show of hands? Everybody else has stopped at the table? Okay, or you did it at Salvation Army. Okay, thank you. All right, thank you. Enjoy your breakfast.
So I'll go to Arch and I'll pick up the big stack of surveys that'll come to me, and I'll start sorting them by county, because typically we don't have to worry too much about duplication or overlap between the counties. They get entered and I begin just sort of tabulating categories. I report those numbers to Arch. Arch is responsible for entering those numbers, and they get reported to HUD along with the housing inventory count at the same time.
Point in time count is like a snapshot that the country takes of homelessness every year. And certainly the point in time count is not a precise count of every single homeless person at that time. For a long time, we really did not have data about homelessness. And we spent a lot of time, various different people, the government and nonprofits, arguing about how big the problem was. Some people said there were 3 million homeless people. Government said there were 250,000 homeless people. It's difficult when you go to Congress to try to get resources if you have no clue what it would take to solve it, because you don't know how many people there are. And also, it's important to be able to show progress or lack of progress. So the point in time counts, the data from that, have really been essential to building the public and political will to get resources to try to bring the number of homeless people down.
Say a lot of people don't realize they're only a couple of paychecks away from being homeless. And then you don't think about it until it happens. And then, I don't know. Then God help you. He's the only one that can. Yeah.
Now, the question I ask about any welfare reform proposal is, will it help people become self-sufficient and lead a full life, or will it keep them down in a state of dependency? I'm afraid that several members of Congress have suggested some proposals that, while claiming to require work-related activities, would make staying on welfare more attractive. Their misguided compassion would only bring more people into the welfare system, encourage them to stay on the welfare rolls longer, and discourage work.
We have a relatively weak support system. It's a business-run society to an unusual extent. Policies are designed pretty much by the business classes for their own benefit. And the generally weak social system has had effects all through the society. Homelessness is one reflection of it.
With this bill, we say if you don't pay the child support you owe, we'll garnish your wages, take away your driver's license, track you across state lines, if necessary, make you work off what you pay, what you owe. It is a good thing, and it will help dramatically to reduce welfare, increase independence, and reinforce parental responsibility.
A Clinton program, 1996, of basically eliminating welfare, it looked for a while as if it wasn't having much effect. And by now, the number of people living in poverty is outrageous. The number of people living in extreme poverty, literally $2 a day, is huge. Now, there was a phrase that was used in the 1950s by John Kenneth Galbraith. He talked about private affluence, public squalor, which was not quite accurate then, but now it's becoming very real. And the homeless people on the streets are one reflection of it. It's just inconceivable that that could be tolerated in the richest country in the world.
There is no question that the richest country in the world can afford to end homelessness. And we know what to do to end homelessness because housed people are not homeless people. I think the fundamental issue is that elected officials and policymakers in this country have not done their jobs, not at the federal level and not at the local level. Over the past decades, they have not supported a decent living wage for people, and they have allowed or even promoted the destruction of millions of units of low-cost housing, clearly with very little intent of replacing it.
From an all-time high of nearly $53 billion, HUD's proposed 2020 budget is slashed by $9 billion. HUD Secretary Ben Carson defends the massive cut by claiming to be good stewards of taxpayer dollars. Unfortunately, it will increase homelessness, and the real cost to U.S. taxpayers will be astronomical.
In our studies, we generally interview somewhere in the neighborhood of 250 folks over a couple of days period. And I looked at those questionnaires and added up the amount of money that would have been spent on police calls, on hospitalization, emergency room visits, and this type of thing. And it averaged about $37,000 a year per person that we spend. And I often say to people, we would be better off to put people up in a fancy hotel for a year rather than spend $37,000 maintaining them on the street.
In a presentation for the State Department today, you talked about something that I thought was really interesting. You said that you were struck by the extent to which caricatured narratives about the purported innate differences between the rich and poor have been sold to people by politicians in the media. Just explain that a little bit.
So the rich are industrious, entrepreneurial, patriotic, and the drivers of economic success. The poor, on the other hand, are wasters, losers, and scammers. So as a result, money spent on welfare is money down the drain. Money devoted to the rich is a sound investment. The reality is that the United States now has probably the lowest degree of social mobility among all the rich countries. And if you are born poor, guess where you're going to end up? Poor.
I'm old enough to remember the 30s. And it was much, in absolute terms, much worse and far worse than now. My own family, mostly unemployed, working class. But there was a sense of hopefulness that somehow we can get out of this together. There isn't that attitude today. That's a real triumph of propaganda, because the possibilities now are greater than then. And the wealth of the society is way beyond what it was then. But with the kind of collapse of organization, of unions, of other forms of association, the atomization of society, the sense that everything's going wrong and I don't know why, that can lead to very antisocial decisions and choices.
Where are you taking me now?
My time with you, Ebenezer, is almost done. Will you profit by what I have shown you of the good in most men's hearts?
I don't know. How can I promise?
It's too hard a lesson for you to learn. Then learn this lesson.
Spirit, are these yours?
They are man's. They cling to me for protection from their fetters. This boy is ignorance, this girl is want. Beware them both, but most of all, beware this boy.
But have they no refuge, no resource?
Are there no prisons? Are there no workhouses? Are there no prisons? Are there no workhouses? Are there no prisons? Are there no workhouses?
Interesting period of time in our country as to the cutback in social services. And if the proposed budget goes through, I think we're going to see some very drastic cuts. Always the religious-based, the faith-based organizations have played a major, major role in providing services. Without those, we would be in a great state of crisis in trying to address the homeless problem.
The Lord said my house was going to be a revolving door. Whenever somebody would come in and get everything that they needed and move out, that He'd bring me more. And that's exactly how it's been going for the past 2.5 years.
Father, please bless the hands that prepared it, which is Miss Kathy. Thank you. And we just love you. We thank you and we praise you in Jesus' precious name. And we agree as your children, Father, by saying amen.
Amen. So I became very ill, entered the hospital while I was in the emergency room. They said, where do you live? I explained the situation. They said, there's a lady here. Her name is Joanna. She takes in homeless people off the street. Would you like to meet her? I said, okay. She came in and talked to me, and I thought, this woman is a complete nutter. Who in their right mind would take me in? You don't know who I am. I could be a mass murderer for all you know.
They're just really amazed. Like, why would you want to take me home? You know, and they're a little skeptical. But once they get here and they see and they feel the love of the Lord here and they see, like, okay, there, what's the catch? There is no catch. There's no catch. The catch is that we want to help them.
He knows that they're still not in a place where they're married so they can be as intimate as they want to be. He knows that there are still some boundaries between them. That's still worth recognizing. They really love each other. They really want to be together, but they recognize that there are still some areas where they have to maintain some distance while their relationship will not allow for that because God wants them to remain pure.
And so several of us who got together and planted the church just kept coming back to this area, It's like, for some reason, we need to be in this area. We found this building. But the more we were here, the more we met people who would just wander in. We have windows where they can see us, and we have usually cold soft drinks, and we are nice when people come in. And so we didn't come in with a targeted, we're going to go help these people, but whoever shows up, that's who's supposed to be here.
Honestly, I would probably be on the streets. Knowing me, more likely I would have killed myself. And so for the last 5 years, I've been in and out of institutions, couch surfing, homeless. All the trauma that I had as a child, mental, physical, and sexual abuse, I thought that that was past me and I was okay and healed, so to say. But I wasn't. And it all came flooding back. 11 months ago, I had just finished a treatment stint at the VA, and I didn't have anywhere to go at all. I had burned all my bridges. So I was thinking that, you know, I would try the Salvation Army, and God led me to this place. Since I've been at Manda House, my life has changed not in ways that I wanted it to, but in ways that I needed it to change. You know, I, like many men in this country, express themselves in some very dysfunctional ways. And I'm just learning how to not do that.
I don't know anyone that just gets out of bed one day and says, I want to be homeless. I think that looks like a wonderful life that I'll live for the rest of my days. I don't think that it's a choice. I think it is a storm that happens where the circumstances and the stars align to get you there. It can be anyone at any given time.
A lot of jobs that I've had in my life, when I'd get up in the morning, I really didn't look forward to going to work, you know? When I get up in the morning at Manor House there, I look forward to coming here, you know? And that's what tells me that, you know, this is where God wants me. Really, there's no way I could ever pay back what the Manor House has done for me. I want to be able to help the next alcoholic and drug addict that was like I was when they come here not looking to get clean and sober.
I say that we have the best clients because I get to see who they really are. Not when they're using, not when they're manic, when they are who God intended them to be. And they are the best people I have ever met in my life. I met through this house, through this program.
A typical night, we'll see somewhere between 400 men, women, and children. Now, coldest part of winter when it spikes and the hottest parts of summer when it spikes, that number can go as high as 500. And we have had those days when we've also served upwards of 1,500 or 1,600 meals in a single day, directly proportionate to the number of people who are spending the night.
We have completely reshaped the entire way our organization operates. Everything from how we respond to a person when they come through the front door to unprecedented opportunities that they have to end that homeless condition for hopefully forever.
I traveled for, I say, about 2 weeks. And I was in bus after bus, truck after truck, around a new person after new person. And they weren't all nice. And a lot of them would drop you off in the middle of the highway. I'll only get you this far because you're not doing something for me. And eventually ended up at exit 347 in Knoxville. And the police officers had brought me in. I gave them my stuff. I signed in right away. They gave me a meal, and I was hungry. I had been out at the truck stop for probably 2 nights.
If they have a choice between helping this person or this person with some limited funds, the person that's showing that they're trying to do the right thing, which would be, I'm paying towards my bill.
The idea behind LaunchPoint is that you're creating an action plan for yourself. Well, it's not so much the quality of the plan, although that's important, but it's the fact that you have a plan. And this is your plan for how you're going to move forward in your life.
This program has opened my eyes and said, hey, stop, look, take these steps and just make that move and change your life already and stop taking those steps back.
And what we want to do is make sure that we're moving a person forward on a positive trajectory with momentum. So if you kind of look at this stair step on the bell, I was under the bridge. I came to CARM. I went to Crossroads. I went to Launch Point. I have a plan. I'm on the bridge. I now have an address. I have a place where my mail can come, a place that I can call my own. I live in apartment 303 on the bridge. What a wonderful thing for someone to be able to say. We make this exceptionally nice so a person can taste a different level of living, and hopefully when they move from here, they'll want to move to a place that is as nice or nicer because now they've seen what life can be like and you don't have to live under the bridge anymore. CARM is funded primarily, but not exclusively, through the generosity of our donors who believe in what it is we do. But we also have income-producing businesses that generate income for the ministry. We use those income-producing businesses to create job and training opportunities for the folks that we serve. So it's donation income and income-producing businesses that really allow us to do what it is we do every day.
They call this place God's living room. And so folks tell me this is the only home we really have right now. When I first saw this place, I wasn't convinced that this would be where a storefront church could be, but certainly after we've located here, it could have never been anywhere else. And so we immediately began realizing the numbers of people who live on the streets, who are homeless, and who are marginalized in our community. And so we wanted the DNA of this new congregation to be one of acceptance of all people.
We have a slogan here at Shades of Grace. We say that we help the least, the last, the lost, and the lonely. And the least, Jesus said, if you do this unto the least of them, you've done it unto me. It's a God-given call for us to do this.
We discover lots of folks do not have a valid photo ID or a social security number or a birth certificate. Without a photo ID, you do not exist. So at this point, we have purchased photo IDs for well over 170 people right here in this location. When we first came here, it seemed that nobody wanted to recognize that there is a problem of homelessness in Kingsport. And so we've kind of put a face on that. And no longer can the people turn a deaf ear and a blind eye. It's here, and it's in our community. So what are we going to do about it?
But I want you to bring your burden up here, whatever you have that is in your hand. And I want you to take it, and I want you one by one and drop it into the water. And I want you to see what happens, okay?
Set those troubles free. Give your heart to Jesus.
Emmanuel Lutheran Church came to us to see how they might be able to partner with us, and so they have designated a large plot of ground in their big cemetery. And so we have already buried 17 homeless persons there.
Glad you're here this morning as we respect the lives of 8 people that have now passed into God's eternal rest.
Edward Wimmer, August 24th, 1954, died May 15th, last week, 2019.
If you come to campus in the fall or in the spring, you'll see Dr. Dula carrying a cart behind him. Why is he carrying that cart? Because he puts it in the front of his classroom at the beginning of every lecture session and encourages students to put supplies in that cart, which then he takes to Bucky's food pantry.
Based on our present day response to homelessness, I would say the future doesn't look much better. I don't believe that there's a real awareness of the issue. Thus, there isn't much being done to really address it holistically. I'm encouraged by the fact that you're doing this documentary. I'm encouraged by the fact that the people that you've come in contact with are all people who are allies to help alleviate the problem. And I'm encouraged to see that the businesses and the community that I live in actually do try to get engaged and find compassionate solutions to common issues.